The Charge in the Darkness is one of those concepts for a game that is so brilliant that I'm surprised this is the first time I've seen a game go this route. But in the same breath, it feels like the goal kind of outpaced the reach of the design. And that may be a little hard to explain here, but we're going to try. The game itself is developed by Richard Rouse, who's probably more famously known for being the creative director of The Suffering, a really great action horror game that also had a lot of choices and kind of branching narratives around those lines. And this game definitely follows in part and parcel there. The concept is that we have been tasked by our strange sister to find our nephew, who has joined a cult, and we need to figure out what's going on with this cult. Is our nephew okay? And then kind of have to make a judgment call. The game itself is played via or majorly by stealth design. The main form of stealth detection is through vision. Every enemy has a vision cone you can bring up, and you can run and circle around and do whatever you want to them as long as you're not, or you don't cross that vision path. The only other ways of kind of avoiding or mitigating the stealth are by throwing rocks that are used as a distraction, putting on disguises that lower the vision cone, or having distraction-based items that you can use. Now, here's where the game gets very interesting. The map itself is handmade. However, building placements, objectives, and kind of your actual goal is randomly shuffled each time you play it. So in one play, you may find your nephew on the west side of the map. On another play, he may be on the north. And your starting and escape points are also randomly chosen. Now, those kinds of aspects in a stealth or roguelike game, that's, you know, routine at this point. But it's what The Church in the Darkness does with the story and how things progress that really begin to show kind of where it's trying to elevate the design. The entire playthrough of the game is somewhat on the short side, especially when you start playing it. All you really need to do is get to your nephew, figure out what to do, get on out. And if you find everything quickly, you can be done the game in maybe 5 to 10 minutes of play. But the choose-your-own-adventure aspects come into play with how the story progresses based on your choices. The two cult leaders have their own personality, and in a very unique twist, their personalities are randomly shuffled depending upon your playthrough. So on one play, they may be more willing to listen to you and maybe let your nephew go just by talking to them. Another one, they may be far more militant, and you're going to have to do more or maybe even fight them. There are guns and weapons you can use, but for the most part, you're not really supposed to fight the people in this game. Again, a lot of the cultists are just people who have been converted or have been taken in. And the game will keep track of your actions, whether or not you've been caught, you've killed, or incapacitate, and so on and so forth. And it reminds me a little bit of Prey by Arcane in that regard. And as you progress through the game, if you get caught, the game will keep playing. You'll be captured and you'll have to break out. And it's, again, a very weird take on this kind of choose-your-own-adventure roguelike kind of design. And as you play through, you're going to basically stumble upon notes and lore that will hopefully help you, as well as additional gear. But for the most part, the gameplay is kept on the short side of things, or on the simple side. Now, with that said, though, we're going to take our quick Patreon supporter and shout break, and when we come back, I want to talk about why the game feels like it doesn't quite reach the expectations or the concept that's been pitched, and we'll talk a little bit more about kind of what the game expects out of you in terms of repeated plays. But first, let's have that shout out. And now a quick shout out to our current Game Wisdom Patreon supporters and sponsors. And if you'd like to continue this discussion on game design, be sure to check out our Discord channel, linked down below. The goal of playing The Church in the Darkness is to get one of the game's many, and I do mean many, different endings. And at the start, both your options and the routes open to you are kept very low. Chances are most of you watching this right now who are interested in playing the game will probably get one of the failure endings when you first start playing it. Part of that is due to the UI, and we'll talk about that one in a minute. But once you've completed a route of the game, you'll get like this kind of little vignette that goes over your choices, and then you're taken to the list of endings. And as you can see right there, this is when the game gets very interesting. The more you complete the game, the more story elements and kind of options become available in subsequent playthroughs, much like other persistent focus roguelikes like Dead Cells, Slay the Spire, and obviously The Binding of Isaac. And this goes to not only expand what's in the game, but also give you a greater sense of the story. Each one of the quest givers are unique NPCs, and their objectives, again, are going to be randomly shuffled based on the map generation and what's going on. And when you combine that with the, again, like kind of like the choose your own adventure style, it gives the game a unique taste or a unique element of replayability by the fact that you're going to get legitimately a different story each time you play it, which only grows deeper and more interesting the further you go in. And like I said at the start, there really hasn't been a roguelike or even just a traditional game that went in this direction in terms of growing the narrative and the story around it. However, this is where we can kind of start to talk about some of the issues I have with The Church in the Darkness. From a UI standpoint, the game felt very cumbersome to play. And during our play on stream, I switched between keyboard and mouse and gamepad, and neither one felt fully comfortable to me. The UI has a lot of like weird button locations and just some general quality of life problems that I had with the game. Now, keep in mind, we played this pretty much the day of its release, so there is a possibility that some of these issues may have been fixed or will be fixed in a future patch. But, for one thing, it was very hard sometimes to get close enough to a character to trigger whether to kill or incapacitate them. And the button presses don't feel like they have a secondary association, so you kind of have to memorize what buttons do what. Another issue is that the viewpoints, like while the overall environment of the game look okay, the character models are very low quality. And while it may not seem like a big deal, part of the challenge of the game is being able to read what directions enemies or characters are facing and kind of go by that. But in many cases, it becomes impossible to tell what direction characters are looking, as well as what their vision is. The stealth system in this game is entirely abstracted. Again, I can run around somebody and they won't hear me, but if I toss a rock, they'll immediately go running towards that direction. But even with that point, there are some issues. You can't see on screen where your rock is going. It's based on your direction. But you'll have no idea of knowing how far you're going to throw it, who's going to hear it, and things like that. And from what we play of the game, it felt like the majority of the items and additional options you can pick up didn't feel all that useful to me. Like, if somebody saw me, that was basically it. Like, it didn't matter if I took out an alarm box or not. Likewise, once you start running to characters who are armed, unless you can take them out immediately, they're just going to knock out your health very fast. This is especially true if you play the game on the hardest civilly setting, that is one hit, basically you're captured, game over, that kind of thing. And I think for a lot of people who are going to play this game, they're going to try it out, run into some of these frustrations, and then not even get to see what this game has in store. I mean, even when we were playing this on stream, everyone was starting to feel like this game was going on enough, switch to something else. And that was before we even got our first real ending. And I think that's another issue. Unlike a game like The Binding of Isaac or Dead Cells, where progress or meaningful progress can happen win or lose, it seems like you can only unlock new stuff when you get an ending. And that can be a lot of playing before somebody sees that system. In fact, a lot of people were surprised when we played this on stream that that was a part of the game mechanics or the game systems. And that scene that I showed you at the start of this part, that occurred about an hour to an hour and a half into our play. So if you quit the game or you don't get any endings and you stop playing, you're not going to witness kind of the main hook of The Church in the Darkness. But to begin to wrap things up, like I said, from a concept standpoint, this is probably one of the most brilliant and original ideas I've seen this year. But its presentation and UI, I feel, are probably going to drive away more people than the concept is going to get them invested in it. The stealth design just feels a little too simple. There's just not a lot of depth or emergent behavior that you would kind of expect from this kind of design or this kind of philosophy. But this is one of those games that I feel that you are either going to love or hate it. And I'm curious, for people who've played this game, what do you think about it, especially if you played it further and unlocked more content? But I would definitely like to thank the developers for giving me a press key to check this one out, and I hope it does well enough for them to kind of continue exploring this concept further. But thank you so much for watching this video. Be sure to check back for daily discussions on game design here and on Game Wisdom, where we're using the art and science of games. And if you'd like me to include your game in the future, don't hesitate to get in touch. But otherwise, that is going to do it for The Church in the Darkness. Thanks again for watching, and I will see you all later.